Let's bring our hands together for the founder of the Instagram page, How to Raise Bilinguals, Sweta. Am I saying it right, Sweta?
Yes, yes, yes. Thank you very much.
I'm Thank so you, Sanan, happy for to having you.
Go ahead. Thank you, Ta.
No, you and then I, okay?
Okay. Thank you so much for joining us, Sweta. I'm so glad you're here on Momnificence.
Thank you for having me, Tanya. I'm so glad we finally met, right? I've seen all your videos and I'm really glad to just join you.
So tell us something about this platform you've created. What are the tools you provide about yourself? Tell us something to all our viewers who are so interested in this topic about raising bilinguals and multilinguals. And
so when you ask me, I get a little bit confused, like who am I and what I'm doing, because actually, based on my education, I'm a linguist and teacher, and then my only major part of the life is teaching kids speak multiple languages and foreign languages, right? But what I'm doing on Instagram, I'm trying to connect with many families who probably facing some difficulties in this field. So, I'm a bilingualist and I work at school, and then I have like all my education is about languages, and then I had a child. And due to our multicultural situation, because my husband is from Latin America, so we face the issue that our child is supposed to be trilingual, right?
Correct.
It's not even like a wish. It's a mandatory requirement. It's
correct.
Yes, and the funny thing that I was at that moment when I had a child, I enrolled into the graduate school in the States. And my major was in the teaching English as a second language, and I had the one of the classes where it was about first language acquisition.
Correct.
And I had a toddler in the house. So I'm reading the book and I'm looking at her, And then I'm just like, wait a second, she's doing exactly what the book said. How is this possible?
That's awesome.
So and I started to pay attention. And yes, it came out like all our kids, regardless of their race, gender, social, economical status, they all pass through the same stages in terms of the language acquisition. And then down the road, I just noticed that when there are many languages, there are even other situations that are common for little babies who start speaking several languages. And this is the way how I became a multilingual consultant.
So that's amazing. So your own daughter was a source of learning information for you. So I'm sure a lot of mothers would relate to the problem you mentioned about your husband having one mother tongue and then you speaking another native tongue and you living in the USA, so you want to speak English.
Yes,
so
exactly.
This is like a problem faced by everybody, and we are so honored to have somebody like you who understands this, because first step is admitting that there's a problem. Okay.
Wow.
And then you go ahead with dealing with the issues. So tell us something. How did you approach this? For those who don't know, Sweta also has her own YouTube channel. So if you want any guidelines, any online classes, she's all here to help, and she's very approachable and friendly. So you can always check out www.youtube.com for how to raise a bilingual baby, and she will be there to assist you on Instagram as well. But more about you, can you please tell us about how did you get this idea? I mean, you spoke about the development of the idea, but what do you do on this? Like, how do you approach it?
So, you mean how parents raise bilingual kids or multilingual kids,
yeah,
right?
Actually, let's start with bilingual, because that's a little more understandable. And then we can go to multilingual, right? Or whatever you'd like.
Well, anything that more than one language is definitely like a little bit more challenging for the family, right?
Yes.
But if you have just bilingual, I would simply enjoy the life in both languages, like without even thinking like how I'm gonna do that. Just to acquire language, kids have to have exposure to that language, so they have to hear that, they have to listen, they have to see people communicate in that language. Otherwise, so they see the purpose, like, oh, that's a useful thing, so I can connect to those adults.
Correct.
And some people, I would say, recommend sticking to different policies, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, for instance, it depends on your family composition. We, if you, let's say, an Indian woman married to an American man, then, and you both have two different languages, then the best probably way to do that is to speak each language separately, right? This is what one parent, one language policy. If, let's say, you are a family of Indians inside the United States, right? Then obviously the best way to keep up with the language is to speak your home language at home. Okay. And educate people or educate kids in the major language, right? It could be any language.
English.
Here we have English. What then? If you have like really complicated multilingual composition, my multicultural family, right, where there could be several relatives that speak different languages, then I would like recommend you, if you want to keep them all at least at some level, we're not talking about super proficient, but at least being able to communicate. Yes, ask your relatives to speak each language, the one that they are the most proficient.
Okay.
So
how little is too little? Sorry to interrupt you, but isn't it so overwhelming? I mean, small babies, they understand languages, like how, what, at what age can I introduce a baby to different languages?
Well, I would say before birth is the best way.
Not talking.
Yes, okay. By talking, by singing, by anything. So babies are born to learn language first. That's their only job, sleep, eat.
I wish I knew when I was little. I would learn so many languages.
Well, it all depends on exposure, right? Experience. If you are a parent, expose you to different languages, you would learn them. If because it's very interesting that you are from India, you guys have like over 3,000 languages in one country.
Only three.
Oh my gosh, only three. Complaining, right? Because most of the people whom I know from India, they said, "Well, I'm kind of like, I know five languages, right?"
So yes, that's basic.
English, Hindi as official, then my official dialect of my region, then vernacular form of that region dialect, and neighboring dialect as well, I know.
you're right. So I'm glad. Tell us something about yourself, from where you come and how you dealt with this problem. Because you speak, I think, you speak Russian also.
Oh, yeah. I'm ethnical Russian, right?
Okay.
My family speak Russian, and we are like have our traditions Russian.
Okay.
But I was born on in Central Asia, on the border with the, like, China, with the China, and then like Afghanistan and other countries. So we had like a real melting pot where two official languages, right? This is how the government operates. The school system works, two official languages. And then probably over like 30 different ethnic groups with all the cultures that takes them. So it's like, for instance, we had these ethnicities from China who practice Muslim religion. Then we had another that country has the name is Kyrgyzstan, right? So the native population is Kyrgyz, so they are similar to Native Americans, kind of.
Wow,
so
that is fantastic.
So that type of childhood gave me a big understanding of the world that is bigger than just something one, right?
Yes.
And I'm really happy that I had this type of childhood because... I just remember, my neighborhood was like for instance, Muslims on one side, we are Russians. Then we have one more, like, deviation of these ethnicity. Like,
okay,
and
wow.
We all celebrate our holidays. We go visit each other, share the food, invite each other to the home to celebrate. So like year long, we have this exchange of different things, because when Muslims have their holidays, we don't have, but when we have, they don't have. So, and they, so that was so cool to grow like this. So I actually very, so it's very logical that I ended up into my marriage with a husband from like across the globe, because he's from Peru. And I'm from Kyrgyzstan, Peru and Kyrgyzstan, two countries that for many people, yes, non-existent.
Wow. So this is your personal life. Now, since we also touched on the topics, how you got your experience, because you were exposed at a very young age to multiple languages, multiple cultures, and you grew up. So I'm sure you miss all that here, because here you're training your child. It's only you who's dealing with English and your husband's language and your language. So what is the best way to approach? I mean, parents from the platform are very excited to learn a few things. So I'm going to name a few parents and ask you, what is the best strategy? Is there a strategy you have in mind to do this? Like, how to deal with this?
This is, continuation. I just read, right? There are minimum probably 7 ways of how families plan on the languages, right? Somebody has tracking the progress this way, somebody has a real plan, somebody has nothing, it's just like spontaneous teaching of the language. Some people read books in other, I don't know, sing songs. This is the job of every family to figure out what works for you the most. Yes. The most important part is that the if you have two languages, the time child spent in every language should be approximately equal, then this child is gonna grow up like rounded up in both languages very well proficient, right?
Got it.
If you have like, let's say like us, 3 languages, then for instance, we practice that husband speak most of the time in Spanish to the child, like from the birth, right? And I was the parent who spoke 2 languages, because major, of course, Russian, but we also cannot deny that we are inside the United States and we have to speak the local language too. So I was the one who was a parent who spoke 2 languages at the same time.
Wow.
So how we did? I'm not gonna I cannot generalize for every family, but when you have 3 and more, you just like I did, right? I just double everything into second language. So I speak something in Russian. How is gonna be this and that? And right after, I follow myself up in English. So and in parallel, because most of the parents, they strictly understand if it's a poll, like one parent, one language. So then they have to refuse from one of the languages. Mm-hmm. They have a dedicated day when they speak that language, and they speak only that language and nothing else. I can assure you, the child can easily figure out what language you speak, even if you're going to mix them up together, because the research says that our kids before 9 years, months old, they are completely universal hearing machines. They can hear every single sound. They hear everything, right?
Wow.
Then, through the exposure to the caregivers, to the parents, by somewhere 9-11 months, they shut down the part of the brain that's responsible for everything, and they start concentrating on learning the language or languages that are the most frequent in the environment. So from from universal hearing into narrow, monolingual, bilingual, or trilingual, whatever lingual, right?
Wow.
So the best time to start is, of course, from the scratch, from the beginning, if you're proficient, because there are situations when the parents are not speaking that language, but willing to pass that language. And this is the case of English language, right? All around the world, parents want their kids to start speaking English first. And then, because it's English is the access to education, right? To jobs to, it's economical, economically very profitable.
Yes, and everybody understands it. Like, for instance, you and me, we start speaking in English because I assume you would know English. You assume I would know English, right?
Yes,
yes. So that's the first thought on our heads. Yes. So besides from making each other comfortable in the language, you mentioned how research says, you know, at an early age, they start understanding universally. And then they shut down to monolingual and then they go to bilingual. And how parents... the caregiver's responsibility to speak and find your best strategy, right? I mean, every family is different.
Yes, yes.
Every child is different. So whatever suits best, the guidance is given as per that. Mm-hmm. But there's a question from a particular follower. Her name is Suhasini, and she wants to know, does a child get confused? I think you already mentioned that they have a hearing of universal languages, but there's a misconception about parents that they feel they speak more than one language. The child might mix up the objects or the subject and just get confused between the native and the mother tongue. Is it a myth? Tell us something about that.
It's actually, you know, I just thought you guys, again, back to India, right? You guys speak five languages.
Yeah.
Are you confused?
Yeah, how can we get confused?
Yeah, how you don't get confused?
Yeah, we feel children, I don't know why. I feel in India, we end up overprotecting a child.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So we end up over-sympathizing, oh, the baby is so small, oh, how can the baby do this? But the research says that maybe from a very young age, they have been prepared to hear so many sounds.
Yeah, absolutely. So the point is that we humans are the smartest at the birth. So we have the biggest amount of the brain capacity when we are born. So there is nothing what we cannot handle at that age, except, of course, like, physical damage, right?
Got it.
So, about the confusion. Confusion is not in the heads of the kids, it's in the heads of the parents. So that's the name. As I said, so if you expose your child by a certain age, they clearly understand what exactly you speak based on the phonetical properties of that language. So they hear the sound, because English is one type of the sentences and rhythm, right? Indian, like Hindi, for instance, is different, right? And we are talking about other languages. They are all very like a music of the language is different in every
specific
case, right?
Yeah, very specific sound.
From my child, I know precisely by 9 months old, she knew exactly when the papa spoke Spanish and mama spoke Russian, and she also replied back in the sounds that are attributed to those languages.
Amazing.
And what happens is just with this mythology about delays, it comes out from the not understanding how the brain works, right?
Yes.
Because our eyes, ears, mouth, nose, and skin are organs to collect information. So if somebody touches you at the back, right, with you without looking, in the matter of the microsecond, you already know somebody is touching, even if the ant is crawling, right? Why?
Yes.
Because your skin felt the micro pressure somewhere, and those nerves, right? They collected the data from source, send it to the brain. Brain got the data. Process into the right place where this information is supposed to be processed. And then it fires back response. What to do? Run, stay, is it safe, is it not safe? So brain takes those decisions. So eventually it fires you a response to turn back the head and take a look. Wow. Who is touching your back, right? So in terms of the language, we hear the sound. Sound goes, neurons, they picked it up, delivered to the brain, brain processes and fires back response to the throat, and we answer with this speech. Like speech sounds, sentences, words, and back. When we are talking about delay, right? This delay happens precisely in this logistical chain of collection, delivery, processing, and delivery back of information, right? Precisely in the mechanism, it's not in the... in outside, right? The language is a box with information that is coded into with the special symbols. Every language has its own symbols, right?
Yes.
A sound, a letters, a sound. So those those boxes, they are not inside us, right? So we cannot, it's like a post office. We cannot blame the boxes for the failure of the postman, right? The postman is sitting inside of us. When child has a delay, it's this logistics of the collection processing and replying is broken somewhere or is not working precisely. For instance, let's say the child has some hearing disability, right? The rest of system of transportation, processing in the brain and firing back response works fine, but the collection of the sounds is not working. So his ears, due to some sort of mechanical or I don't know, whatever dysfunction, cannot process those, collect those sounds, right? The rest of system works. Sometimes child can hear sound, but that delivery chain is not functioning well, or the brain is not placing that information in the right place, right? Or the response is not fired that fast, or the muscles at the end of the throat, right, not working properly. This is where the child has all those phonetical dysfunction. No, when they're not pronouncing sounds, is that some muscles of the tongue are not listening to the brain. So what I want to say, and parents understand, that delay is inside. Nothing from outside can affect it. It can be because of the, I don't know, genetics can give delay to the child. Some chemical imbalance, some physical damage, something that is like breaking our body or was like from the birth there. Languages can cause only anxiety or, I don't know, depression or something, because it's a cognitive load. I mean, this information packed in different form is not going to make a damage physical to us. It's just make us a little bit overwhelmed. That's maximum what they can do. So when you expose your child to several languages, there is no way how those several languages can impact your child's internal biology.
Yeah, I love the way you gave the example of the brain and also the example of the package. So it's not the fault of the post.
Yes, just think about like if there is a delay in the child, it's like a postman in the traffic jam.
Yes.
Whether he is dealing with one package transporting or there are hundreds of them, unless he starts moving in those traffic jams, these packages are not going to move.
Okay.
And this is what happens with the treatment when they send a child to the therapy with the like speech pathologist, for instance. They treat the entire system that operates those languages. When the system doesn't work, whether it's one language or two, child is gonna not talk. You know, it's not gonna like his speech is not gonna be good. Once they with their, because they have all the methods and they are trained for that. Once after therapy, they improve this like this processing system, right? They train muscles, they do something, right? Maybe some medications. Then all of the packages start moving.
Yeah.
At the same time, this is like if system broken, nothing works. System fixed, everything works fine. So don't worry. It's not, it's like, but I want to say that regardless your child monolingual or bilingual, somewhere from 7 to 17% somewhere of the kid, in this range, kids are going to have some sort of issues with the delays or, so always look at the child and if any concern, always apply to first, to pediatrician, right? So, to the doctor, right? Never be ashamed. This is nobody's fault. It's just a statistic. They might be. Plus, girls are a little bit faster in language acquisition. Boys have always a little bit slower process of learning.
So it's all inside. I love the way you are educating all the viewers about all the knowledge you possess because you've learned all this. So for everybody watching, please don't use your own assumption. Please contact an expert,
speak
to your pediatrician, and there's nothing wrong with the child. Don't get anxious about learning because I feel if you are positive, then your child is positive about a language.
Oh, yes,
the moment you get overwhelmed and excited, then the child gets affected and does not want to learn, correct?
Correct, correct. I want to add because I had this question from several parents. So they all ask, like, my child used to have a delay and we had a therapy with a speech pathologist. Now the child is graduated for several years already from this treatment. Can we go back to our home language and learn it? Yes, of course. My reply, yes, of course. And I was asking several, like, SLPs, and they said the same. So if your child had already treated one of those disorders, and now a child is normal, you can proceed with any languages without fear. Don't worry. It just requires a different approach.
Yes. So that's a great answer for people who are struggling and are confused and busting a few myths, and how to explain the with the examples for the brain and the skin and everything. It just sinks so much better when you have an instance to relate to and make it so simple. So for your guidance, I really understand that you highlighted delays for us. You mentioned about the package and the development and everything. So tell us something. Sometimes we notice, as we mentioned earlier, that there's an accent when you speak in a particular language. So when one of our mothers, her name is Prisha and Mama. So when she speaks in English and she speaks in her native mother tongue, there's an English accent to the Hindi she speaks to. So is it a normal thing? Why is there an accent when you speak on in one accent affecting the other?
Well, it is perfectly normal because languages in one person, they are interacting with each other, right? We cannot pack them into the boxes. Once you put them inside of you, they start penetrating. Yes. I'm sorry for my explanation. I'm just like all of the fingers, right?
Perfect. So that's how I understand. I love doing actions myself. See my fingers.
From the same school.
Yeah, it's common.
So when it's okay. She has an English accent, the child has, because the English was the first and probably the major language. Right? Mm-hmm. That's why there is a transfer from that the most active and more developed language into the other one. It's a normal for every single bilingual or multilingual to have a like not even indistinct accent. You cannot say it's a Russian or Indian. It's a kind of mix of in between.
Mm-hmm.
And unless there is a serious problem with communication, I wouldn't touch at all, because especially kids, they are like in the process of development, they're going to fix it by themselves naturally, right?
So
like I have example with my daughter, because the last year we lived in the Russian speaking country, and I sent her to the daycares. They had a like on daily basis, they had a speech pathologist who pulled her out without my knowing and tried to fix the R sound.
Okay, R.
Because R in English is a here, in Russian it's a R, and in Indian, can you tell me? So it's a completely different place of articulation, right?
Got it.
So I didn't know, she took her to the class like 30 minutes of, like not the therapy, just like of the class with her. And she comes back home with a funny accent in this R. And I'm like, where did you get this? So she started to tell me, this is that teacher. She was teaching me to do this and that. Eventually, so speech pathologist moved this articulation from, I didn't see any problem with that. But she, by some reason, noticed the accent, tried to fix, and that air went to the, like, deep in the throat, like a French,
necessary sometimes.
Yeah, it's like,
if it's not broken, don't fix it.
Yes, it's not broken. It's a norm, because we all have accents, and even inside, like, monolinguals, they do have accents, and nothing wrong about that.
We all do have accents. And also puts me down to a last question from besides what you're saying, from another very interested parent. Her name is Megha Purohit. She wants to know that the guidance which you give is all strategy based, right? Depending on every family, every child is different, but the same thing as you said, you know, in India you have more than one language, you introduce one, you introduce the other, and then you balance out between the father and the mother, or whatever for the child. So to train a child at an early age, is it difficult to pick up multiple concepts? Because this is more about multiple languages now, because many people speak five languages or four languages, as you said. So it's easier for a child to pick up many meanings for the same object. Like this is a cup. Okay. So cup, and what, do you give multiple names to the same object? or do you start slowly? Like, do you take baby steps, or how does that happen? If you could just give us a little highlight on that.
You know, in general, speak naturally, right?
Okay, yeah.
Because if I when I was babysitting with the baby, my baby, right? If I take a cup, I would say it's a cap, it's a чашка in taza in español. So I would repeat all the words at once. She doesn't mind, because my kid, regardless of the five languages, she never missed any milestone, and even more, like, she was ahead of them. And she never got confused, and she actually never could switch until, like, late, right, around 4 years old, or maybe, like, almost five. And this is was, like, social code switch, to pinch somebody, you know, to say something, like, using language, right, like a weapon. So, regardless of your question, right, first, there are, I think there are, like, a couple questions here. First, it's, is it about, like, can we speak multiple languages in one household? I think, yes, you can easily, again, don't worry about kid. Kid is not going to get confused.
Okay.
Kid cannot get confused, right? It's just physically impossible to get confused with those. And they are much smarter than we are. And then, second, can I use several languages, code switch, code mixing inside one sentence? Yes, you can, but the purpose, right? What is the purpose of doing so? If you are like a parent who provides couple languages to your child, right? Then yes, you can do. If it's just like because there are like a language and code mix is sometimes a like social issue, right? To just rebelling teenagers. So if you are just got used to that, or you do it on purpose to make somebody upset, then this is like
that's later.
Kids copy what you are doing, so be mindful about what you are doing. Languages you can mix, you can live in the multiple households, you can introduce early or later. There is a prescribed step-by-step action plan if somebody wants. Or be free, do whatever you want, and just be consistent in what you're doing, right?
Okay.
It's like if you started to read twice a day in both languages, or like once a day in both languages, then keep doing that until the child starts speaking. Because starting and then dropping and then starting and dropping, that's not a good idea at all, because they will get confused. So are you interested in that language or not? That's what they are gonna get confused with. Is it useful language for me? Because majority of there was a question, right, like, what's the point of teaching a home language if anyways kids are gonna speak English at the end, right?
Yes, so that's also very...
The main point of teaching you second and more language is that they're going to be better at literacy. Down the road, the consequences of being multilingual is not that you can't speak the language, or you can't gonna go to your village to communicate with your relatives. That's not the point. What happens, interesting, is that kids who learn that one thing may have several concepts and may have several names, easily start reading in English. That's what the main advantage of being multilingual. Because monolingual English speakers struggle with the idea that A, B, C, the names of the letters, right? They have different sounds. Like, how come, like, A, the name of the letter, produce an R, right? Oh, that's impossible. But B, sound is a B. They cannot get. I've heard that million times from parents. No, not million, exaggeration, right? I've heard many times that struggle that this K letter, right, produce K sound. Bilingual have no issues with that. They know that things can have many different names, they can have many different properties, and they're fine with that. So that's the advantage. Plus, there was a one experiment, I'm gonna, if you want, you can check it in my feed on Instagram, right?
Please repeat your Instagram page one more time for everybody to hear all the sessions.
So it's at how to the number, raise bilinguals. How to raise bilingual. So on my page, you can find the different resources and the researches and steps. And now I'm working on them. Some like guide for age wise, right? So what you can do with your child at certain age in terms of bilingual, what to play. But there is a video where the babies, monolingual and bilingual, how they solve problems. You have to see that because it's gonna give you immediately totally different understanding of like what do we mean of being bilingual and what is what type of advantages it gives, because the way how non-verbal infants solve the problems is completely different, monolingual and bilingual. So this is what I recommend everybody to take a look.
Look at that video, everybody. It's fabulous because that's very good information. I mean, the point of learning a second language is not that you have to speak to your relatives or go back to your country and talk about it. Mm-hmm. It's your perception. It opens your mind that letters don't just have one sound or one meaning or one object. Mm-hmm. It can mean a lot of things. So you're opening your own eyes and your brain to more options at an early age. So that's like really eye-opening. I really enjoy talking to you about this session and about all the concerns, about all the doubts, not just other parents, but even me as a mom, learning from your experience, because it's so nice that you are so open to sharing, communicating, and whatever you have learned. I mean, I myself have received an ebook from you on your recommendation. So she is very specific about the child you have. You can tell her how many months your child is, and she'll guide you on her YouTube channel. She's already mentioned her Instagram channel, her Instagram page. So please feel free to follow Sweta on how to raise bilinguals. And it was such a pleasure to have you. Is there some message you want to give to us before you sign off and want to tell us something before you go?
Well, thank you, Tanya, for inviting me. I really enjoyed every single second of this talk. And I'm really so happy that we met.
Yes, finally.
Finally, yes. Hopefully not the last one, right?
Yes, hopefully not. And this has been such a pleasure for me as well, and a learning experience. Thank you for being so patient and so clear about understanding and helping us with all the confusion and myths we had regarding things. And stay in touch, take care, and stay safe. Love to your family.
Thank you very much. Bye.